Hello, I'm Reverend Sam, and I'm your host on The Secret of Glory and Power. Why do we have this program? Because it is said and it is true that the secret of men is in their stories. The intention is to look at stories that teach us the morals of life. Look at stories of people who succeeded, who failed, so that we can learn from their own mistake and learn from their success steps. And I want you to know that this program is especially meant to show you the path to follow. Some of us have made mistakes that lasted for maybe 10 years, maybe 15, before we're able to realize the mistake and then take the appropriate steps. And the intention of this program is to ensure that you don't have to spend 10 years before you know the right step to take. Because there's nothing new under heaven anyway. That's what the Bible says. So something that you are thinking of doing, someone else must have probably done it. The step you are thinking of taking, someone else must have probably taken it. And if you can learn from their stories, you can get to your own realm of glory faster than other people. And that is the intention of this program. And because I am anointed of God, there's an anointing upon my life for supernatural open doors. And the reason why I say that is because I want you that is watching me right now to take advantage of this anointing. When a prophet of God passes through your life, let them leave something good in your life. How can you be of help? Bring your advert to this program. Tell your friends, tell your spouse, tell your colleagues to bring their advert to this program. By doing that, you are helping us to establish this program, and you are helping us to be able to also enlarge the number of minutes we're able to spend on here. So as you bring your advert and we enlarge, you will definitely enlarge. One, because you are helping a vision that is helping somebody else. And whatsoever a man sow, that shall he reap. And number two, because you are also helping my vision, and I'm anointed of God, and every prophet has their own reward. So my reward will be able to follow you. And are you watching me right now? You have had experience in life that you feel that others need to learn from. Maybe you have gone through situations and you have made mistakes, and you have been able to, you know, correct the mistakes, and you have now done the right thing, and you have success story in whatever area. Might be in business, in marriage, in spiritual work. Just call the number on the screen. I'll call you back. I'll hear your stories. We will hook up. And once I know that your story is what is, we can hear to people, we will make an arrangement on how you and I can come to the studio, record, so that somebody else can learn from what you've gone through. Today, I felt in my heart to speak about the poor wise man. The poor wise man. That seems to be like a contradiction, because anyone that is wise is not supposed to be poor. But the word of God also tells me that food does not always belong to the wise. The race is not always to the swift. There are certain things that happen in this life that sometimes good people experience bad things, but that's not the way God ordained it to be from the beginning. Something has gone wrong. So let's look at the story of this man so that you and I can learn from his story. I'm going to pick his story from the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 9. I'll read from verse 13 to verse 16. The Bible says, Solomon was talking here. I have also seen this example of wisdom under the sun, and it seemed great to me. There was a little city with few men in it, and a great king came against it and besieged it and building great siege work against it. Verse 15. But there was found in this small city a poor wise man, and he, the poor wise man, by his wisdom delivered the city. Yet no one remembered that poor man. Wow. But I say that wisdom is better than strength, although the poor man's wisdom is despised and his words are not heard. When we look at the story of this man, he resided in a very small city. The Bible said there are few people in it. And then there's this great king. Of course, for the king to be called a great king, it means that the king must have a large population of people in his country. I don't know what he was looking for in this small city. Maybe there is treasure, maybe there is gold, maybe there is oil, maybe there is anything that is of value in this small city. And this great king wants to capture this small city, enslave them so that he can take advantage of their treasures. And we are told that both the king, all his cabinet officers, every person that seems to matter in that city, though the city was small, could not find solution to the problem. But there was this man that was in that city, who dwelt maybe at the outskirts of the city, who dwelt in the suburb, and he was called the poor wise man. That's a contradiction. But by his wisdom, I didn't know what he told the king. I did not know the strategy he gave the king for them to apply. But we are told that by this man's wisdom, the small king with few people in it were able to overpower and overcome the great king with many soldiers. Now, I would have expected that after the war, this poor wise man should not remain poor. But we are told that nobody remembered him after they have utilized his wisdom. So I want us to learn from him. And then in verse 16, we are told there that wisdom is better than strength, but a poor man's wisdom is not heard, and his words are not respected. Little city, few men, that means they have few soldiers. But there was this man there that his wisdom, I don't know how he developed the wisdom, but the wisdom was able to help. Maybe you are like that, you know. Maybe when your big corporation, when they are in a mess, when they don't know what to do, an idea comes to your mind, and because you are just a regular factory worker, maybe a junior staff, and then you share the idea with them, and your supervisor took the idea to his own manager, and the manager took the idea to the board meeting, and the CEOs and all the executives of the company said, this is a great idea, and they utilized it, and the problem was solved, but you were not rewarded. As a matter of fact, your manager was promoted because he didn't tell them that you are the one that gave him the wisdom. So, how can you fix it? You may not be able to fix the problem that you have solved before, but you can learn from today. You know that? It may be in your company. It may be anywhere. Anywhere. You remember David? Because I want us to go straight to what I want you to learn from here. Because I feel for this man. Why didn't he do like David? When David heard that Goliath was shouting and ranting and was saying that he was going to destroy the king, King Saul, and the whole army of Israel. He was in the camp. His father sent him to go see his brothers. When he heard what this man was saying, he said, what did the king promise to give to the man that will slaughter this man? He was conscious of reward. He said, I kill lion, I kill young bear with my bare hand and with my sling. I will kill this Goliath. But what is it that is going to be in it for me? He learned to strike a deal before he provides solution. This is one of the mistakes of this man. And I'm speaking to you because I believe that you may have lost certain opportunities, but more are going to come. Because whatsoever a man sow, that shall he reap. If you have given solution to a smaller problem, God is going to give you opportunity to give solution to a bigger problem. Remember Joseph, he gave solution to the dreams of the Pharaoh's officers. And within a period of 2 years, he was before Pharaoh, the greatest king in the whole world at that time, to provide the same solution. That's why I believe that another chance will come for you. David said, what will be the reward? They said, the king said he's going to do this and this. Okay, take me to the king. Let me strike the deal. Let there be an official written oath between us that if I can kill this Goliath, I will get the reward. And of course, they took him to the king. You know why? Let me tell you one secret. When people are in problem, it is easier for them to sign the dotted line. It is easier for them to give you a contract when they are in desperation. And so you that know that you have solution to a problem, do not give solution until you have secured the reward. You know your solution will work. They don't know. So when they are signing that contract with you, when they are going to that agreement to reward you, they are probably thinking in their mind, after all, it's not going to work. Yeah, let's just sign it. Now, you know it will work, they don't know it will work. And it may be the only opportunity that you have in life. It may be the only opportunity that your children have in life. One man of God, a great man of God in Africa. When I was in the United Kingdom, I was speaking with a bishop that owns a TV station where I preach. And the man said that this bishop told them at the minister's conference that when he first started, he was doing some programs in hotels. And then he said, one military officer came to him and said, what do you want me to do for you? I like your ministry. I like you. The man said, I don't want to do anything for me. Just give me an oil block. Far back in the early 90s, and the contract was signed and the oil block was awarded, and nobody heard about it in Nigeria. I had to travel to UK to hear it. Jephthah, remember Jephthah? They threw Jephthah out because he was a bastard. Maybe you're going to go to that later. They took him out because he was a bastard, but he kept on developing himself, and the time came that they had a problem. They remembered and they heard that Jephthah had become a mighty soldier and he had some followers. They went to go and meet him. The elders of the town went to go and he said, if I win this war, what will you give me? They said, you will be our leader. What am I trying to say? Don't be like this poor wise man who was eager to give his wisdom for free. Even if he's not sure whether the wisdom will work or not, he should at least get a promissory note for a reward. I hope you are learning, because I am. Now, at your level, with God's wisdom, you can achieve incredible results. No matter how you are, no matter your level, even if you might be a slave, you might be a nobody today, but as long as you have God on the inside of you, which means you are a child of God, you have given your life to Jesus, the Spirit of the living God dwells in you. Did you know that the Bible says the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of wisdom? And did you know that in the book of 1 Corinthians, the Bible says that God has made Jesus to become our wisdom? So if you are a child of God, you have the wisdom of God in your life. All you need to do is to believe that inside your heart, that with what you carry, with what you have, you can succeed. You may not be able to solve every problem, but there's always a peculiar problem that you have the wisdom inside you to solve. It might be graphics. It might be beauty related. It might be environmental related. It might be technology related. It might be spiritual related. It might be marital problem. It might be herbs. Maybe you have understanding of how to put herbs together and make medicine, and then people will use them to heal. Something God will give to you. If you think you don't have anything, you need to pray. But what I'm trying to say is that you don't look down yourself. This man was a poor wise man. He didn't look down himself. He was sure his wisdom will work, and he gave it out. Though he was foolish in giving it out without expecting a reward. Now, let me now quickly go to the spiritual outlook, because I want to make sure I wrap up this story within one episode. The spiritual outlook of this man. Now, in the book of Proverbs chapter 8, the Bible was talking about wisdom. And I want to quickly read it, because I want you to see what I'm talking about. Proverbs chapter 8, and I'm going to read from verse 17 to verse 21. Proverbs was speaking here. Wisdom was speaking here. I love those who love me. That is wisdom speaking. And those who seek me diligently will find me. Riches and honor are with me. If wisdom says riches and honor are with him, how come this man is a wise man but he remains poor? Enduring wealth that does not end, and righteousness, in other words, the fear of God. My fruit is better than gold, fine gold, and my yield is better than choice silver. Verse 20. I walk in the way of righteousness, in the path of peace. Verse 21. Granting an inheritance to those who love me and filling their treasures. Wisdom is supposed to make a man wise, a man rich. How come this man remain poor? You know, when I was meditating on this thing, I said to myself, We have to begin to believe God that the wisdom God gives us will make us rich. You know, there are some people that they always know what others should do to get out of their problem, but they don't know nothing about what they should do about their own situation. That's a contradiction. If God uses you for others, the same anointing that works for others can work for you. Wisdom is supposed to fill this man's life with wealth, but he remained poor. So let me give the spiritual outlook. Number one, you have to pray of inquiry. If you are the kind of person I'm talking about, you have many people that surround that can help you. People that can give you idea, that can give you money, connect you to some contracts, but nobody's ready to help. And yet they come to you when they are in trouble, you give them wisdom, you give them advice. They go use your advice and they come back and say, oh, thank you for everything you give us. And then they give you like $1,000. But that's if they give you anything. You are worth more than that. Wisdom should make you to be a possessor of treasure. So number one, prayer. I call it prayer of inquiry. In the book of Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3, God said, call upon me and I will answer, and I will show you great and mighty things I have never known. What am I trying to say? There may be a spiritual problem against your glory. There may be. So you've got to pray that prayer of inquiry. And after you have to keep praying that prayer of inquiry until God reveals to you. How God will reveal to you is another subject altogether. You might have dreams. Thoughts might be coming to your mind. You might just subconsciously be reflecting on the past. Somebody might be saying something that will give you a clue. After you have prayed that prayer, it may take weeks, it may take months. Sometimes ago, my own took years, but I finally got it. Now, after that, you have to sit down and analyze your findings. When you are praying and God reveals this to you, sit down first and analyze. Analyze your finding. And this may take time. Analyze it. Maybe you need to get certification so that your wisdom can be respected by the great. Maybe you are naturally talented. I know a woman in Nigeria that was talented in fixing broken bones, you know, and people go to her. But maybe if she's in the Western world, she can go for a kind of course that can give her official certification. Then with her special skill, she can begin to command higher respect and higher funding. You have to analyze. You have to ask yourself, what are those things I am doing that keep me poor? Because nobody will pay you for something you are willing to give for free. Nobody. I was talking to one man one time. We were talking about our schools, and I said to him, I said, listen, parents will not be willing to pay you more if you are ready to collect less. So there is always a way you can position your gifting and your talent to attract wealth. In the beginning, you might give them a teaser. You know, when you go to every store, there are these kiosks that you see that say, take free sample. You know what they are doing? They are giving you appetizer. They know that if you truly love it, you want to come back and buy. You can give appetizers. You can just let people see what you can do. And then, when they have come to taste what you can do, and they come to make a request for you, you tell them it's going to cost you. Because now they have gotten a taste of what you have, and they are coming to tell you that they need what you have, then you are going to now put a price on it. The price may not be money, it may be money. It depends on you. But wisdom is supposed to make you wise. Remember, it may be spiritual. So if it is spiritual, you have to sit down, analyze it, pray about it. Maybe you need to go for deliverance, you need to see your pastor, you need to connect with people of God that can help you out. And apart from prayer, you need to sit down and organize yourself. Maybe the way you are, rich people cannot come because you are not in the right environment. You are not positioned properly. Some of you, maybe you are even better than me in speaking, but you have never ventured to come before the camera. You say you don't have money, you don't have money. Nobody has money for whatever they don't value. If you value something, you will sacrifice for it. Jesus said the kingdom of God is like a man that finds a treasure under the ground. And he went to sell everything he has and brought the money to buy that land. Because he knows that he that owns the land owns the treasure. Whatever you think is of value to you must be able to attract whatever you have. Even if it means you wear one cloth 1 year, I don't care. My vision is my future. A man that has nothing to look forward to in the future is supposed to die today. Jesus, he endured the cross and despised the shame because of the joy ahead of him. What are you seeing ahead of you? Analyze. And then number three, check your circle of relationship. Friendship has great influence. This man probably is among the people that are poor, and they're always talking poor men's talk. They're always talking welfare check. They're always talking government is supposed to take care of us. We have served this country. They're supposed to take care of us. Now, it may be among the people that don't have initiative for greatness. You've got to change your friendship if the people that surround you are not going anywhere, because you will always end up modeling and mirroring the people that surround you. If you have one friend that can encourage you to move forward in life, it's better than have 10 friends that are mediocres who are not going anywhere. This is the purpose of this program, to challenge you. You've got to sit down and think. Now, the next thing I want to say also is that anyone with great glory will attract great opposition. Stay close to God. This is a major problem with many people. They want to remain in sin and the glory to shine. If that's what you want to do, you had better go and sign up with Satan. He's the author of sin, and he will land you in hellfire, but you will enjoy on this earth. But let me ask you, how many years will you enjoy this earth? Probably 50 years. Maybe 30 years. In fact, what Satan does is that when he gives them that kind of money, that kind of glory, it doesn't last. 10 years, it will disappear. And then you will not spend eternity, thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon thousands of years in hellfire. But you can stay with God, succeed with God on this planet earth, fulfill the plan of God for your life. And then when you die, you will be with Jesus eternally in heaven, enjoying for the rest of eternity. You've got to make a choice. But the truth is that anyone that has great glory must expect great opposition. So when people say, Reverend, we dreamt, we saw opposition against you, I said, okay, I expect that. You know, I was speaking with the pastor of our church in Nigeria. They started a program, and I told them to start some program early this year, and they started. And the pastor began to have a lot of satanic opposition from some fake prophets and some imams, and then they were saying that he is delivering the people that they have chained. And then he was afraid, and I said, listen, why are you afraid? You should expect that if you are negatively affecting the kingdom of darkness, they are not going to fold their hand, they are going to try to fight back. So all you need to do is sit down, know your scriptures for defense, and continue to use it. And of course, I have to pray at that time. And God, and the power of God waved off every attack that was against the pastor at that time, because he was almost having a heart attack. And they have to rush the person to the hospital. But you see, something like that doesn't bother me. And people say, Houston is filled with great darkness. And I say, wow, that's wonderful. This is the right place for me to be, because I am the light of the world. So I shine more when there is thick darkness and there is no power from hell. Not even Satan is too small to confront me. You know why? Because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I am in this world as an ambassador of Christ. I am covered by God's covenant. So when I am sent to places, I know there are people there that need to be delivered. And that's why I want to quickly announce to you that if you believe that you want my anointing, there's a program that I organize. It's not a church program. It's a ministry program. You see, I call it All Believers Conference. Even if you have not given your life to Jesus, come to that program. We are going to pray. The theme of the program is overcoming satanic opposition to your glory. Overcoming satanic opposition to your glory. The intention is to face the enemy and the oppressor of your destiny, so that you will not remain poor like this man. Now, the date of the program is Friday, 8th June. It's the second Friday in the month of June. Make sure you mark your calendar. Put a reminder on your phone so that a day before, your phone can give you a reminder. It's a program you don't want to miss. It's one-day program, and the program starts by 7 o'clock. It's not all night. 7 o'clock. Between 7 o'clock and 9:30, 10 o'clock, we're through. and make sure you come. I will be teaching you on how to operate with the power of God. And we're going to be focusing on prayers. And I'm trusting God that the grace of God on my life for word of knowledge, word of wisdom, seeing things will come around. And God will deliver you if you are there with faith. The venue of the program is Divine Heritage Hall, 9755 South Kirkwood Road, Houston, Texas, 77099. You know, Kirkwood is off Bissonnette. So as you are going, when you are going on Bissonnette, you get to Kirkwood, just look for that particular address. It's not far from that junction at all. It's not far from that business hall. You know, the place where this Family Dollar is, not that place. You know, when you are going on that Kirkwood Road, it's like 2 minutes drive, and then you are in the church. Divine Heritage Hall, 9755 South Kirkwood Road, Houston, Texas. And if you need to know more, you can call the number on the screen, 872-731-7263. 872-731-7263. I want to make sure that you come with your family, because God wants to deal with every problem that the enemy has been using against your destiny. And I believe as you come, you will have testimony to share. So I hope to see you there very soon. Wow. Lord, I give you all the praise. Now, I want to tell you about the success secret that I have for you today, and that is associate with like minds. Now, if you want to be a successful athlete and you are always moving around wrestlers, you will end up becoming a wrestler. Maybe your intention is to be a very good computer engineer, but you are always moving around automobile mechanics, you are going to end up becoming automobile mechanic. You will always become the people you move around. So my success secret is associate with like minds. There are people that are going your direction. Associate with them. Maybe you are watching me right now and you know that the hand of God is upon your life and you don't know how to go about it. Why don't you connect with me? This is not a church thing, it's my ministry, you know. Connect with me and we can begin to relate together. And if I see you are not serious, I'll cut you off. I don't have time for those who don't, I'm not going anywhere. Now, let's relate together. So I told that the wisdom God has given to me, I've been in ministry since 1994. So the little wisdom I have can help you. And my exposure, my experience in pastoral leadership ministry can also help you. So I want you to know that we all need one another. I'm going to go right now, but I don't want you to forget this man. Don't be another poor wise man. Whatever it takes for you to get out of that situation, please do it, because your future is at stake here. I'll get back to you next week. I'm Reverend Sam. God bless you. Bye-bye.